Well, good evening, folks. So, wait, good evening. Better. Good to see you all here again on this, our final night of our week of ministry, searching the scriptures. And we've enjoyed having our brother David with us this week, ministering God's word and dealing with a very difficult and a vast topic and trying to get through as much as we can in the time available to us. We certainly appreciate him taking the time each day to travel here and back again, and the time that he spent long before this week preparing. And I just want to say on our last night, a big thank you to David, and we really appreciate all the work that he's put into it and the effort that he's put into rightly dividing the word of truth. And we do appreciate that. We're looking forward to the final night tonight, the perseverance of the saints. And he sort of teased us a bit last night, saying that it might not be what we expect, or that some people might expect, and we're looking forward to that as well. But we're going to sing before Stephen opens our meeting in prayer tonight. And we sang this at one of our fellowship times a while back, and the words may not be that familiar or familiar at all, but the tune will be. It goes to the tune of "I Cannot Tell Why He Whom Angels Worship," or if you're more secular-minded, goes to the tune of "And Boy." All right, so you'll know the tune, one way or the other, and trust that we'll enjoy singing this one together, reminding us that this world is not our home. We're just passing through, and someday we know that we'll be taken home to glory. Wonderful to have that assurance. But let's stand together as we worship the Lord.
Yeah.
Amen. Amen. Thank you so much. I'll just ask Stephen now to command us to the Lord in prayer. Thank you, Stephen. Thank you, Stephen. Well, for the last time this week, again, thank you, brother, for coming. I'm just going to hand the rest of our time over to Brother Dave.
Thank you, Dave. Well, thank you, Pastor Cosby. It's a blessing again to be here tonight and to have the opportunity to open the Word of God this one final evening of your week of Bible ministry, searching the Scriptures. I appreciate so much those who've come out each night, and I trust and hope and pray that the messages have been helpful to you and that they have been encouraging along the way. That's our purpose, really, is that we should dig into the Word of God and understand something of the Lord Jesus and of our salvation and all of the blessings and privileges that are ours in Christ. If you have your Bible tonight, we're going to begin reading in just 1 Peter chapter 1. And verse 10, it's a verse that we've touched on already this week. And we are thinking tonight about the perseverance of the saints, the fifth point on the tulip acrostic. And verse 10 of 2 Peter chapter 1, and verse 10, it says this: "Wherefore, the rather, brethren, give diligence to make your calling and election sure. For if ye do these things, ye shall never fall." And we trust the Lord will add his blessing to the reading of his precious word. I don't know about you, but when I think about the word perseverance, I think of someone maybe who is trekking across the Sahara, or somebody who is swimming the English Channel, or somebody who is climbing up Mount Everest or engaged in some other activity of that kind. Persistence or perseverance speaks about persistence. It speaks about the stickability and the constancy to achieve something despite difficulties or failures or opposition. And so, you know, what do Calvinists mean when they speak of the perseverance of the saints? Well, most Calvinist brothers and sisters that I've met along the way usually take this particular point to indicate that a Christian possesses eternal security. And, you know, that seems fair enough, but it always struck me that the terminology didn't seem quite right somehow if this was indeed a statement about eternal security. And so for a long time, I didn't really look into this. I just accepted what other people said about it. And I just took it that whilst I certainly wasn't a five-point Calvinist and didn't hold to the first 4 points, that I probably agreed with the last point, and I might have been, if there's even a possibility of being such a thing, a one-point Calvinist. But now I realize that I'm actually not a one-point Calvinist. I'm a no-point Calvinist. And I want to explain to you this evening why I'm a no-point Calvinist. I want to begin, first of all, by understanding perseverance. Let's understand perseverance. Calvinists have an obvious problem. They have a difficulty. Their problem is summed up in this question. How can I possibly know that I am one of the elect? How can I know I am one of the elect? After all, if God made some choice concerning me in eternity past, before the world was ever founded, before I ever came along, how can I know that I am included in that? Is it not possible that I could be deceived or deluded into believing that I am one of the elect when in fact I am not? And the answer to this conundrum is really given in this fifth point of Calvinism, perseverance of the saints. And so the notion is simply this: a true Christian will persevere. He will stick at it right to the end. So Calvinists underpin this particular teaching with certain proof texts, Matthew 24, 12 and 13, because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold, but he that shall endure unto the end, the same shall be saved. John 15 and 16, you have not chosen me, but I have chosen you and ordained you that you should go and bring forth fruit and that your fruit should remain. Philippians 1, 6, being confident of this very thing, that he which hath begun work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. And again, Philippians 2 and 12, wherefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, not in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling, for it is God which worketh in you both to will and to do of his good pleasure. And such verses continue in Calvinist theology as proof texts of this doctrine of perseverance. And essentially the same idea is presented throughout these and other texts, that a Christian will endure to the end. He will persevere to the end. He will not fall into deep sin, and he will not fall away from the faith. That is not possible for someone who is a true Christian. And if he does, it's proof positive that he wasn't one of the elect after all, and that he wasn't saved in the first place. Now, as we've seen with so many of these texts this week, this one is no different in this respect. The proof texts are very often ripped out of the context in order to establish the case. And we find that, for example, in Matthew chapter 24, the reference there about he that shall endure to the end, the same shall be saved. And really that has nothing to do with a Christian. It begins with a question from the disciples concerning the end of the world, concerning the future of the messianic promises. The Lord instructs them that the temple is going to fall, it's going to be taken apart stone by stone. And because they understand that the temple must be in place for the Messiah to come and establish his kingdom, they're curious then as to when the world will end and when the kingdom will come. And Matthew 24 is the answer to that question. And the Lord Jesus effectively works them all the way through the tribulation period, right up until his judgment at the end of that tribulation period. So it's got nothing to do with our salvation. It's talking about the signs of his coming. It's talking about the end of this age. And as I say, he's speaking not about you and I, but he's speaking in that context about tribulation age saints and how things will be so difficult for them that should that period of time be permitted by God to extend beyond that which has been decreed by the Scripture, it would result in the physical annihilation of the Jewish people and of the nation of Israel. And that becomes clearer in verse 22, where the Lord says in chapter 24 of Matthew, except those days should be shortened, there should not be saved. That's very critical. He's not talking about soul salvation. He's talking about physical political and national salvation. He said that there should be no flesh. He says that he's going to send out his angels to gather in the elect from the four corners of the earth. And they say, well, that's the church being gathered in for Christ's coming. Well, wait a minute. The Bible tells us there that the elect belong to certain tribes. Which tribe is it that you belong to? Which tribe is it that I belong to? Was the Lord talking about Zulus or Zutus or Comanches or Picts or something? No, he was talking about the tribes of Israel. So the elect in Matthew chapter 24 has to do with the tribes of Israel. It's got nothing to do with our salvation, and it's got nothing to do with us enduring to the end in that sense. Now, I don't want to spend this whole evening going through proof text after proof text to gainsay what Calvinists may say to defend their particular doctrine. But I rather want to think through the teaching, because there are ramifications here in this subject as there are with the others. So we want to begin by unpacking perseverance. Look here again in 2 Peter chapter 1, and I want to read down to verse 10. We did touch on this passage earlier in the week, but I want to come back to it again, looking at this from a different angle. And it says, Simon Peter, a servant and an apostle of Jesus Christ, to them that have obtained like precious faith with us, through the righteousness of God and our Savior Jesus Christ. Grace and peace be multiplied unto you through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord, according as his divine power have given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness through the knowledge of him that hath called us to glory and virtue, whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these you might be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. And besides this, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue, and to virtue knowledge, and to knowledge temperance, and to temperance patience, and to patience godliness, and to godliness brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness charity. For if these things be in you and abound, they make you that you shall neither be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. But he that lacketh these things is blind and cannot see afar off, and hath forgotten that he was purged from his old sins. Wherefore, the rather, brethren, give diligence to make your calling and election sure. For if you do these things, you shall never fall. And we'll go to verse 11. For so an entrance shall be ministered unto you abundantly into the everlasting kingdom of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Now, Peter opens this epistle by exhorting believers to add various virtues to our faith. And his reason being that such virtues will make us fruitful. That's what he says in verse 8. And that if we don't have these things added to our faith, well, then the danger is we will forget that we were purged from our old sins. In other words, a holy life strengthens Christian profession. If you live a sanctified Christian life, your Christian life is going to be a healthier, happier experience than it would be if you did not. So Calvinists take this, and they make verse 10 to imply that the presence of these virtues are a fail-safe guarantee that you are one of the elect, and a lack of them indicates that you are not one of God's chosen people. Let me quote Paul Washer on this. He says, if a person professes faith in Christ and yet falls away or makes no progress in godliness, it does not mean that he has lost his salvation. It reveals that he was never truly converted. But is that what Peter said? I mean, if you look at verse 9 there again, he says, he that lacketh these things, he hasn't made progress in godliness. He who lacketh these things is blind and cannot see afar off, and hath forgotten that he was purged from his old sins. He says that the lack of virtue in the Christian life may lead a believer to a place where he forgets that he was purged. And that word purged gives us the English word catharsis. It means to be cleansed absolutely. He forgets that he was completely cleansed from his old sins. In other words, it will result in him stumbling and having a fall along the way. But he's not saying he loses his salvation or that he never had salvation to begin with. That's not what Peter is saying at all. And in contrast, those who add these virtues to their faith shall experience a glorious entrance into the kingdom. Verse 11, for so an entrance shall be ministered unto you abundantly into the everlasting kingdom of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And in the ancient Greek games, when winning competitors would be given a rapturous welcome when they returned home with their honors, the same as in our own country. If our athletes do particularly well, they get a rapturous reception in London or Belfast, where they may be from. And that's the idea on view here. And so the idea is this: every believer will make it to glory, but not every believer will cover himself in glory when he makes it. But Calvinists have an altogether different view on this. In their minds, carnality, or lack of spirituality, or lack of these virtues, is a sure sign that this person was never saved in the first place. In other words, if you do not persevere until the end, you are clearly unsaved. Stated positively, one must surrender completely to the Lordship of Christ by committing one's will to obey every command of Jesus in order to go to heaven. That is what is meant by perseverance of the saints. Don't believe me? Well, let's listen to what some of the Calvinists say. Let's start with Arthur Pink. He said this: if there is a reserve in your obedience, you are on the way to hell. Now, that's a very radical statement. You know, what does that say about the person who's unsure about following the Lord and believers' baptism? They're on their way to hell? What does it say about the person who's reluctant to join the local church? That they're on their way to hell? And what does that say about a person who perhaps is a little bit timid or unsure about witnessing? They don't want to speak up for Christ. Are they on their way to hell? Because Pink is very clear about this. If there's any reserve whatsoever in your obedience, you are on your way to hell. And John MacArthur says this: no one who denies God should be deceived into thinking that because he once professed faith in Christ, he is eternally secure. So here we have a well-known, prominent Calvinist preacher telling us that you cannot know if you're eternally secure. There's a possibility that you might not be saved at all. Pastor John Otis, a very prominent Presbyterian minister in America, says this: one of the proofs that we are genuinely saved is that our faith will persevere to the end of our lives. So there's no possibility then of long-term backsliding, no going back, no sinning, just this constant, steadfast journey of progress from conversion to the grave. You see this spirit expressed all the time in social media memes when you see things like this: well, you can't be a Christian and listen to rock music, or you can't be a Christian and drink alcohol, or you can't be a Christian and be racist, or you can't be a Christian and not go to church. And if you do this, you're not a Christian. And if you do that, you're not a Christian. Well, what's happening here is we have boiled down the Christian faith to what we do. It becomes works-based. Now, you could justifiably say that a Christian shouldn't be or do any of those things. But to say that he cannot do those things and be a Christian denies the reality that some people do and are those things. And it makes our salvation no longer the gift of God's free grace, but as I say, a matter of works and performance and effort. Now, before anybody accuses me of, and I'm going to use a big word all of my own tonight, antinomianism, which means that there's no law, in case anybody comes along and says, well, that fellow's an antinomianist and he doesn't believe that we have any obligation to the obedience of the Lord, let me put that notion out of your head. Let me say this, a Christian ought to obey the word of God because it's in his nature to do so. You see, 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 17 says that if any man be in Christ Jesus, he's a new creature. Behold, all things are past or passing away, and all things are become or becoming new. So there should be something in me that wants to, at least to some degree, surrender to the will of God for my life. I like what one preacher said, a famous evangelist who was preaching one time. And he said this, he says, you know, he says, since I got saved, I drink all I want to, I smoke all I want to, I swear all I want to, and I gamble all I want to. And the lady pulled him up at the foyer of the church as she was leaving. She said, excuse me, pastor, did you just say that since you got saved, you smoke all you want to, drink all you want to, gamble all you want to, and swear all you want to? He says, yes, I did, but I don't want to. And that's the thing. Now, that said, there are Christians who fall into sin. The Christian life is a matter of growth. Look in 2 Peter chapter 3. We're right there, verse 18. But grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. To him be glory both now and forever. So we're instructed to grow in grace. There are rough edges to be taken off. There are sins, besetting sins, that we struggle with along the way. I remember when I was pastoring in Belfast, there was a man who came in from a very rough background. He was a former soldier, and he had the tongue of a former soldier. He used words that you don't normally hear in polite Christian circles. And, you know, we kind of endured it for a while and thought, well, maybe he'll pick up and he'll stop using these words and he'll eventually, you know, drop them from his vocabulary. And so on one occasion, myself and he and four other men were heading off to Scotland. We had a wee weekend break, and we were heading off as a group of men to do a little tour together. And we got off the boat at Stranraer, and we were making our way across Scotland, heading towards Stirling. And he was conversing with me in the front seat, and he would pepper his conversation with words that, shall we say, were less than Christian. And so I said to him, will you ever stop swearing at me? And he says, what do you mean swearing at you? He says, I don't swear at you. And then one of the men that back of the church car piped up and he says, what do you mean you swear all the time? He says, like what? And so the man reluctantly gave him some of the words that were deemed unacceptable. And so he went very quiet. For about half an hour, he didn't say anything. And I thought, oh, he's grossly offended now. He's upset and he's going to fall out with us on the first day of this weekend. And so I said to him, so-and-so, you're very quiet. Are you all right? He said, I've no more words left. You see, he just needed that little rough edge cut off. He needed to grow a little bit. And that's true of us all. You know, if we say we have no sin, what does the Bible say? We deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. We have sin. We've got besetting sins. We've got struggles along the way. Now, what you end up with here is a performance-based Christianity. If I say to you, listen, you've been saved by the grace of God, but you now have to persevere until the end. And if you don't persevere to the end, that will indicate that you never really had faith at all. Then that becomes a performance-based form of Christianity. And in fact, you can never really be sure of your salvation because, hey, we don't even know if we're at the end. And we don't know how long the end is. It will be away. And so the question is, well, if I'm not at the end could be 10 years from now or 20 years from now. There's still a chance for me to fall away. There's still a chance that I won't endure. There's still a chance for me to deny the faith. There's still a chance for me to fall into sin. So the consequence of that is that I can never really be sure that I am saved. And for me, that is a position amazingly close to what we call Arminianism. You see, there's only a hair's breadth on this point between pure Arminianism and Calvinism. And that's remarkable given the antipathy of Calvinists toward Arminians. Now, listen to what John Piper had to say. Look at this. He says, no Christian can be sure he is a true believer. Hence, there is an ongoing need to be dedicated to the Lord and deny ourselves so that we might make it. We must endure to the end in faith if we are to be saved. Wow. That is a radical statement. And that is what is known, friends, as Lordship Salvation. And when you analyze it, it is really no different from what is taught in the opposite end of the theological scale in Arminianism. Yet Calvinists insist that they believe in eternal security. With classic doublespeak, Piper says this, we believe in eternal security, the eternal security of the elect. Well, that doesn't marry up to that statement which he made there. So here's the rub. How do you know you're the elect? There's not a single verse in the scriptures that will help you know that you're one of the elect. There's not a single verse that speaks of such a matter directly. So the Calvinists are doomed to a lifetime of questioning themselves and to doubt. Listen to the candid confession of the great Calvinist hero, now with the Lord, R.C. Sproul, after he asked himself this question, what if I am not one of the redeemed? Now this is, if you're talking Calvinism and Calvinists, R.C. Sproul is top of the league, okay? He says, what if I am not one of the redeemed? And then he said this, I began to take stock of my life and I looked at, notice what he says, my performance. I looked at my performance. My sins came pouring into my mind, and the more I looked at myself, the worse I felt. I thought, maybe it's really true. Maybe I'm not saved after all. Goodness me. If R.C. Sproul felt that way, I think that bodes ill for those who hung upon all of his writings and all of his words, and it bodes ill for the Calvinism and that he championed. Furthermore, not only does that look bad as far as the doctrines of Calvinism go, it doesn't look good for a host of Bible characters. Think about Noah. Noah, you know well, he's the man who spent 120 years building an ark, preaching, telling men that judgment was coming. In the end, he gets into the ark, he, his three sons and their wives, and his wife, 8 souls in all, and they are saved through the flood. They come out the other end into the new world. What's the last thing that the Bible tells us about Noah? The very last thing that you're told about his life is that Noah planted a vineyard, that he got drunk, and that he lay naked in his tent and was exposed to one of his children. You know, you have to look at that and say, well, no, I'm sorry, but you didn't endure to the end. Yeah, you preached 120 years for a long time. You had us fooled there, Noah. But in the end, we saw what you were really like. We saw what you were really like when you got drunk and lay naked in your tent. We saw what you were really like. We saw that you were a person who wasn't moral at all. We saw that you were someone who was wicked in that sense. And so, Noah, you mustn't be saved. Do you think that way of Noah? Think about Lot, the epitome of a backslider. Lot, whose testimony was so bad that when he witnessed to his own relatives of judgment to come, they mocked him and laughed at him. This was the man who called the Sodomites his brethren, who offered up his own daughters to satisfy their lust. I don't think Lot did very well in terms of persevering to the end here. And yet the Bible refers to him as just Lot and speaks of him as having a righteous soul. How could that be, seeing Lot did not persevere? You know, he started out with Abraham. He started out on a walk of faith. But then there came this point of separation, and he sold himself to the world in terms of the cities of the plain, in the city of Sodom in particular. Or think about Gideon. You remember Gideon, the man who defeated the Midianites? How does Gideon fare in this equation? He ended up with multiple wives and concubines. And then what does he do? Right at the end of his life, he sets up his own religion. Here's what Judges 8:27 says he did. It says that Gideon made an ephod. That's a priestly vest. And he put it in his city, even in Ophrah. And all Israel went thither a whoring after it, which thing became a snare unto Gideon and to his house. Oh, sorry, Gideon, you didn't make it to the end. Sorry, Gideon, you didn't persevere. Sorry, Gideon, in the end, you revealed yourself to be an idolater and an apostate. Gideon, you have gone to hell. Samson? Samson's the epitome of holy living, isn't he? I mean, everybody knows that Samson's one of the godliest of the judges going. Now, here was a man who couldn't keep his eyes off the women. Here was a man who visited with prostitutes. Here was a man who was intemperate in his reactions. Here was a man who was unequally yoked. Here was a man who partied with pagans into the early hours of the morning. Here's a man who ended up dying in shame in the temple of Dagon, having disgraced his calling. And yet, what do you find? You go to the book of Hebrews chapter 11, and both Gideon and Samson get honorable mentions. Remarkable. You think about King Saul, first king of Israel. What is said of him at the start of his reign? It says, the Spirit of God came upon him, and he prophesied among them. That was the beginning. But by the end, where is Saul? He's a bitter, twisted old man who's seeking to wreak revenge upon a man who did him no real wrong. And so in that respect, he ends up consulting a witch. He ends up engaging in necromancy. And ultimately, he kills himself. Saul, did he endure to the end? No, he did not. Sorry, Saul, but you're not saved. In the words of John Piper, you didn't make it. You didn't make it. Or what about King David? A man who committed adultery and then covered it up with a murder? Does that sound like someone who is persevering to you? Does that sound like somebody who is not getting involved in sin to you? Or what about King Solomon, David's son? Did he endure to the end? You know, it says in Scripture, when Solomon was old, his wives, 700 of them in all, a lot of wives by anybody's standard, he says his wives turned away his heart after other gods. I think that's called apostasy. That's right at the end of his life. That's the end of his journey. And so John MacArthur must believe that Solomon, who gave us three books of our Bible, who is referenced by the Lord Jesus Christ in person, he must believe that Solomon was not one of the elect after all, that he revealed himself in his behavior at the end as an unsaved man. He must believe that Solomon is in hell tonight. Is that what you believe about Solomon? What about King Uzziah, one of the great kings of Judah? The start of his reign, we read this, he did that which was right in the sight of the Lord. He sought God, and God made him to prosper. But toward the end of his reign, here's what you read. His heart was lifted up to his destruction, for he transgressed against the Lord. What did he do? He pushed into the holy place, and he usurped the role of a priest, and he ended up being hassled out, and he's struck down with leprosy, and he dies a leper under the judgment of God. King Uzziah, listen, it may well be that at the beginning you did that which was right in the sight of the Lord. It may well be that God prospered you at the outset, but at the end it was revealed you weren't really one of his after all. Sorry. No salvation for you, King Uzziah. Peter. Remember the apostle Peter? The man who Jesus called Satan? That's never a good day in your Christian life, is it? Get thee behind me, Satan. For thou savorest not the things that be of God, but the things that be of man. Here's Peter, who not only denied the Lord once, but denied him three times at the most critical moment in the Savior's life. And then later on, he ends up siding with those who are denying the very heart of the gospel. He gives himself in support of those who are teaching a gospel of works and of religious ceremony. He bolsters their numbers by allying with them. So that Paul in Galatians chapter 2 says this of Peter, "But when Peter was come to Antioch, I withstood him to the face, because he was to be blamed. For before that certain came from James, he did eat with the Gentiles, but when they were come, he withdrew and separated himself, fearing them which were all of the circumcision." He joined with the Judaizers, and in so doing, he denied the faith. From the first to the last, Peter sinned and failed. What about the Corinthian church? The Corinthian church, who Paul begins his writing addressing them as saints as he speaks with them, but goes on to condemn them chapter after chapter as carnal, as schismatic, as fleshly, as immature, on occasions immoral. They were taking one another to court in that church. They were some in that church who were denying the resurrection. There were some who were abusing the gifts. There were some who were abusing the Lord's table. There were some who were engaged in all kinds of wickedness. And what does Paul say to them? "I could not speak unto you as unto spiritual, but as unto carnal, even as unto babes in Christ." Well, which is it? Were they carnal and yet saved? What's the deal here? Because according to the doctrine of perseverance, one cannot be carnal and at the same time be one of the elect. And speaking of the Corinthian church, what about the fornicating brother whose sin was so shameful and so unspeakable that even his unsaved neighbors, his pagan neighbors, wouldn't have committed it? They would have been ashamed of such actions. Paul commands that he be disciplined. He commands that he be put out of the church. That he even be turned over to Satan. But listen to his words. Why was that so? "That the spirit may be saved in the day of the Lord Jesus." He was turned over to the devil for the destruction of the flesh, but that the spirit might be saved in the day of the Lord Jesus. The day of the Lord Jesus, speaking of the rapture. The resurrection of the Christian. And Paul says, look, here's this fornicating brother. He can't even fellowship with the church. But understand this, I want you to discipline him, and I want you to do it in such a way that he hopefully will repent. But even if he doesn't repent and his flesh is destroyed as a consequence of morality, his soul will still be saved in the day of the Lord Jesus. You say, well, wait a minute, what? How can that be? How could these people possibly be numbered among the elect? They're not enduring to the end. They are engaging sometimes in deep sin. Even sometimes they're denying the things of God. The doctrine of perseverance of the saints simply doesn't hold up against the scriptural record of the experience of the saints. One saint after another fell. One after another ended their days badly. Some outright denied the faith, but all of them were saved. So rather than proclaiming the spurious doctrine of the perseverance of the saints, shouldn't we rather uphold another doctrine, the preservation by the Savior? Preservation by the Savior. And that's what I believe in. And that's what the Bible teaches. I remember when I was a young Christian watching an interview on Michael Parkinson's show. Of course, Michael Parkinson died 2 or 3 weeks ago. But I watched this interview as a young Christian back in the early 1980s. And he was interviewing the evangelist Billy Graham. And in the course of that interview, Billy Graham said something that stuck with me. He was sharing the gospel as he was wont to do on these occasions. And he said this. He said, if 99% of getting into heaven depended upon Jesus and 1% upon me, he said, I wouldn't make it. And that little quotation stuck with me as a young believer. You see, thank God tonight that we don't have to rely even on 1% of our own performance. We don't have to rely on our own effort at all. Here's what Paul wrote, for I know whom I have believed, and I am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I have committed unto him against that day. My salvation, your salvation, doesn't rest upon my ability or your ability. It rests upon his ability. It's not your performance that's important or my performance that matters. It's Christ's performance that matters. You see, I still fall short. I still sin. There's every possibility that I might get to the end of my faith. Not be as holy as I might wish, or may not be all that you might wish for me to be as a Christian. But here's the long and short of it. His blood still makes good. Look with me in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 and verse 23. Paul concluding this epistle, and he closes it in some respects with a rebuke upon those who are refusing to work, those who on the basis of the Lord's coming are relying on others and abusing Christian hospitality. So there were problems in the Thessalonian church, as good a church as it was. But he says in verse 23, and the very God of peace sanctify you wholly, completely and utterly. And he says, and I pray God, your whole spirit and soul and body, that's the whole person, be preserved blameless unto the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, he doesn't say, unto the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, if you endure to the end. He doesn't say, unto the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, if you persevere. He says, faithful is he that calleth you, watch this, who also will do it. Who's going to do it? Christ is going to do it. He's going to preserve us to the end. Look at 2 Timothy chapter 4. 2 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 18. The Bible says this, and the Lord shall deliver me, 2 Timothy 4:18, and the Lord shall deliver me from every evil work and will preserve me unto his heavenly kingdom, to whom be glory forever and ever. Paul didn't say, I have persevered unto the heavenly kingdom. He said, no, Christ will preserve me unto the heavenly kingdom. Look at the book of Jude, if you will, in the very opening verse of that little penultimate book of our New Testament. Jude, in verse 1, Jude opens up with these words, Jude, the servant of Jesus Christ, and brother of James, to them that are sanctified by God. Remember, that's our election. That's what God has elected us unto as a group, as those who are in Christ, that are sanctified by God the Father, and notice, and preserved in Christ, preserved in Jesus Christ, and called. By the way, that messes up the order salutis, because here they're preserved before they're called. In Calvinism, you have to be called before you're preserved. But lo and behold, this is the whole back-to-front gospel that we're dealing with, the upside-down gospel that we're dealing with. You see, friends, here's the thing. My assurance and my eternal security rests neither upon my election, nor upon perseverance, nor performance of any kind, but upon the Word of God. The God who cannot lie. You know, I watched a little video. You'll possibly see it if you're on social media. It's a little video that's doing the rounds right now of a young woman who stands up in John MacArthur's church, and they're having a Q&A, and the little woman, the young lady says, well, you know, I don't know how I can be sure that I'm one of the elect. Can you tell me how I can be sure? And you know what ultimately it comes down to in MacArthur's answer? He says, well, the fact that you're worried about this shows that you are one of the elect. In other words, it comes down to your desire. It comes down to feeling. But friends, our faith doesn't rest on feelings. Our faith doesn't rest on our desires. Our faith rests upon the infallible word of God. It rests upon his promises. So that John says, these things have I written unto you that believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life, and that you may believe in the name of the Son of God. And he continues, and this is the confidence we have in him, not in ourselves, not in our feelings, not in our performance, in him. Savior, thou art mine. How sweet the thought to me. Mine, mine, mine. I know thou art mine. That's the key. And some will come and they'll say to me, well, all well and good, Pastor Murray, but what about 2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 12? Well, let's look at 2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 12. And I said to you last night, when this happens, don't panic. But take a breath. And have a look at the passage and see exactly what it does say. 2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 12, and they will quote often the latter part of that verse, if we deny him, he also will deny us. They say, well, there you have it. You've got to persevere to the end. What's your answer to that? Here's my answer. The same as it was last night. Context, context, context. Context is king when understanding scriptures. Notice what this verse says. Verse 11, it says, For if it is a faithful saying, for if we be dead with him, we shall also live with him. What is that? It's resurrection truth. What comes after the resurrection of the believer? The reign of the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's where Paul picks up in verse 12. If we suffer, we shall also reign with him. And when he comes, he's coming not only to reign, but he's coming to bring his reward with him. So verse 12 continues. If we deny him, he will also deny us. Not denying us our salvation, because our salvation is assured in his death, burial, and resurrection. He's denying us a reward. We're losing reward here, not losing salvation. And notice what it says as it continues. If we deny him, he also will deny us. And here's the most remarkable statement of all. If we believe not, yet what? He abideth faithful. He cannot deny himself. That's a powerful verse to reassure the heart of the believer. If I end up even like Gideon, or I end up like Solomon, and my life goes just completely adrift, right at the end or toward the end, and I'm not the Christian I once was, and even if I end up doing something radical in my life that others will strongly disapprove of and the Bible itself will condemn, even in such a case, we find that even if we believe not, yet he abideth faithful. He cannot deny himself. Why? Because it all comes back to this book. And what was his promise? Whoever believed in him would be gifted everlasting life. And that being his promise, he's not prepared to rescind it just because your performance doesn't entirely live up to your profession. The assurance and security of my salvation rests upon his faithfulness, not my faithfulness. So that I say, hallelujah. What a Savior. What a Savior. On every point, Calvinism does hurt to the character of God. It does hurt to the simplicity of the gospel truth that is found in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. Let me close with a quote from John Wesley. Now, I know if I use the words John Wesley, and if there's anyone who's Calvinist, their hackles will be up already. They'll say, well, there he is. He's an Arminian after all. Well, no, no, no. I'm not a Wesleyan. I'm not a Methodist. But I do appreciate this quote. He said of Calvinism that it was a doctrine full of blasphemy, representing our Lord as a hypocrite, a deceiver of the people, a man void of common sincerity, as mocking his helpless creatures by offering what he never intends to give, by saying one thing and meaning another. It destroys all the attributes of God, his justice, mercy, and truth. Yea, it represents the most holy God as worse than a devil, as both more false, more cruel, and more unjust. And so it does. So, my friends, I bear no shame in saying to you tonight, if you haven't got this by this stage, I don't know where you've been, but I bear no shame in saying to you tonight, I am not a Calvinist. I repudiate Calvinism. I disavow Calvinism on every single point. I say no to total inability. I say no to unconditional election. I most certainly say no to limited atonement. I say no to irresistible grace, and I say no to the perseverance of the saints, and I do so for the honor of my Savior. And I want to encourage you to do the same. Thank you for your patience and your kindness in coming out and listening every night and your faithfulness. May the Lord bless you for it. Shall we pray? Father in heaven, Lord, as we conclude this week of meetings, we're so thankful tonight, Lord, that we have a Savior who is faithful and true. A Savior who, even when we would sin, even when we would, as Peter did, as Gideon did, as Samson did, as Solomon did, even when we would deny you in our lives, still you remain faithful because you cannot and will not deny yourself. Lord, I'm so glad for that. I'm so glad that you'll never go back on your word. And I'm so glad, Lord, that when you gifted me with eternal life and you made that promise to me, that it was your intention to keep that promise. Not because of what I have done or didn't do, but because of what the Lord Jesus did that day when he shed his blood on Calvary and paid my sin debt. Lord, I'm so glad that because of Jesus, there's coming a day when all those who know you, all those who've trusted you, despite our failings, despite our flaws, despite our fickleness and our faithlessness, will stand before you blameless and holy, without spot or wrinkle or any such thing. Lord, what a marvelous salvation. What a wonderful Savior. What great reassurance. What a gift we find that day when we trusted the Lord Jesus Christ. Bless us now, Father, as we part company this evening. Lord, I pray that you'll go with us as we travel home. Keep us safe this dark and wet evening. And Lord, I pray you'd bring each one of us back to our place of worship this coming Lord's Day, that we might gather around your throne, one with another, and sing and worship and give praise unto thee. For you are worthy, in Jesus' precious and holy name. Amen.